I was born November 30th, 1927.
And where?
St. Louis, Missouri.
Missouri. Any siblings?
I had one brother, and I had two sisters. I have one left.
Were you raised by your parents or a parent or someone else?
My grandmother.
What kind of an environment did your grandmother create for you while she was raising you?
Well, she, as far as I can go back with it, it was a disciplined environment and an emphasis on getting my schoolwork and making sure that I didn't create havoc at school. And she was on top of everything.
Was it a very loving environment?
Well, it was in one sense, and in another, it was rather strict. There wasn't a lot of touchy-feely, but I knew I was loved and appreciated.
You knew that?
Yeah.
Yes. What was it like racially and economically in St. Louis, Missouri, while you were growing up in the late 20s and 30s, throughout the 30s?
St. Louis was one of those towns that had a southern influx of people, although it was directly Midwest in the center of the country. And there was a southern white influence in the city. However, there were not a lot of manifestations of Jim Crow, or there was discrimination. But, for instance, there were no fountains, white and black. There was no, there was unrestricted sitting on conveyances, public conveyances.
So it wasn't overt, but you knew that it was there.
Yeah, you knew your place, as it were.
In what way?
I don't know. It was just a sense of, we didn't go to the same schools. There was a division there, and a sort of unspoken, but not undefined, attitude when you went to Center City to shop, things like that.
I see. So the schools were not legally segregated, but they were segregated? The schools that
they were legally segregated.
Oh, they were legally segregated.
But what I mean is there was no... I don't remember a lot of overt prejudice.
I see.
Although we knew that you couldn't go in certain stores.
I see.
And you couldn't go, you couldn't eat here. You couldn't eat there, but there were no signs. So it was sort of schizoid in its how it manifested itself.
Now, in your elementary and secondary schools, was there a racial climate, despite the fact that they were predominantly black or all black, as you just said? Was there still a racial climate, perhaps economically, that pertained to economics amongst the African Americans in your schools?
It's kind of difficult to say. Because I was raised Catholic. And as far as I remember, there was, again, not an overt, if one wanted to be a certain thing at 11 or 12 years old, one was never told, you can't be that. In many ways, the graduates of St. Nicholas and St. Joe, black kids, were unaware that there were certain things they couldn't do.
So these were Catholic schools that you attended?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Were the nuns...
I attended a public school after I had shot my mouth off too many times in Catholic school. And for a week, I was exiled to a public school. And I remember, as I look back at it now, I was so sheltered in terms of what I thought about things that I went to the school and I went to recess one morning, and it was for a week, but I went to recess every day, and the schoolyard looked like a battle zone. There were fights everywhere in the yard, and I was standing on the side, practically afraid to move. It was then that I got an appreciation of the environment that I was in.
In the Catholic school?
Yeah.
Were the nuns, were you taught by priests or nuns?
Both.
Were they all white?
As far as I could tell.
Yes. Okay. When you were in high school, did you show any desire to be in the performing arts?
No.
No.
And I had sung in grade school in the little plays, and they put us in those paper mache hats and crepe tutus and whatnot. And we sang our little ditties, and we thought we were hot stuff. You know? But I had done a lot of that, and I had sung when I was in grade school. And I had a particular song that I used to sing, and it was called, it was one of those depression ditties. It was called Just a Kid Named Joe. And I sang that, and everybody oohed and aahed about it. And that was as close as I'd come to the idea of standing in front of someone. It was before I was afraid to do that.
I see. So when you sang this, did you have a good feeling about it? You didn't know at the time that you were interested in singing?
No, I didn't. Not from that point of view. I thought I was hot stuff.
I see. You know, because you were standing in front of an audience.
Yeah, and they were listening to me and I was singing. And I was sort of proud of my voice, and I thought it was an accomplishment of sorts. And but I was always chastened about my performance because there were a couple of other guys in school who could sing and who had a way of singing that was totally unlike my own, and I couldn't quite figure out why they were being feted. I couldn't figure out why anyone wanted to hear them after they'd heard me. And I probably didn't voice it that way, but it was like, as I came later to find out, it was that they were already older than me, and they were really singing. It was sexual, whereas mine was simply, just a kid named Joe. What his second name is, I don't know. But he sells the daily papers, and I buy all my papers from a kid named Joe. I mean, you know, and they were singing, Jilly, 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 Jilly stays on my mind. I couldn't figure, what is Jilly? What are you talking about?
You were too little.
Yeah, I didn't know.
Yes.
And I, at that time, one might find that one was in class with someone who might have been maybe 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years older than you. And you couldn't figure out why you couldn't catch them, why you couldn't keep up with them grade-wise. And I later found out that they quite often were older.
Did you ever finish high school?
And I went back to get the GED.
Yes.
General education, it's not degree.
Diploma.
Diploma.
Yes.
I went back to get that. I was at the school one day hanging out with my buddies who were still in school, and that would have been the class that I'd graduated with. And Sister Anna Adelaide saw me there, and because she and I had bumped heads before. She's the one who threw me out of school, Sister Anna Adelaide. And she saw me standing over there during recess or something, she said, "Young man, would you like to come back to school?" And I figured it would be better not to be disingenuous. And I said, "Yes, sister." And she said, "Well, okay, we'll be here Monday, so and so and so and so. We'll put you back to school, etc." So I went back and I got out. I mean, I got a diploma and, you know, got out. I had missed the, I got thrown out on the 10th. So I had missed half of the 10th and the 11th and part of the 12th. So
you completed everything and then you got your GED and mm-hmm. then what did you do?
Well, then I knocked around and got in the post office, got a secure position in the post office, all the while being in business with the Geraldine clothing shop and that sort of thing. A friend of mine and I, Jack Lazard, and another friend of mine up in Flint, Michigan now, John Hightower, we put together a woman's clothing store. And we had a store down in my old neighborhood. And we had fancy wallpaper and we sold hosiery and dresses. And since we didn't have enough money to really buy stock, we called ourselves an exclusive dress shop. Geraldine's.
Geraldine's.
Geraldine's exclusive dress shop.
Was this named after someone you knew?
It was named after Hightower's sister.
I see.
Yeah.
And then how long did that last?
Well, for Jack, it lasted a pretty good while. For me, it didn't last too long because I was kind of flighty in those days. I couldn't settle on anything. And it seemed like to stay the profession for me. And I didn't like the idea of selling stuff.
I see.
But I mean, I would enter it with as much enthusiasm as I could, and I managed to stay in that triumvirate, John, Jack, and I, you know, for a pretty good while and hide the fact that I wasn't really doing my share in terms of energy.
And you were so young.
Yeah, well.
Yes, you were very young then.
Yeah, but still, it took me a while to know what to take seriously.